I feel like me as a person and Seven Lions in the beginning were not very linked. I've had to kind of become the character throughout the last 10 years, which has been very interesting. Being here and being in this space makes it very easy to like keep that separated, but when it needs to come together, it can. So the first song I ever wrote as Seven Lions was either Luna or The Deep Divide. And those never got released. They're just, I put them on SoundCloud a long time ago. I think one of them's still there actually. Before I put those out as Seven Lions, I was making music as Jeff Montalvo and releasing trance and house on a few different labels. At the time I was going to Burning Man a lot and dubstep was kind of like the thing out there. All I wanted to hear was trance, but there was nobody who was playing trance, so I kind of just got into it because that's what my friends were into, and then I realized I had a lot more freedom working with like broken beats as opposed to just four on the floor dance music. And then I started really liking it, actually. So I think I had to actually make it to really appreciate it. Around 2011, I won this remix competition that Above and Beyond had put on. And that was like a very career-defining, like early.
I remember Jeff picking me up from work one day, and he was like, he was so excited, and he was like, "You'll never guess what I just entered into." And I think he figured out that there was a remix competition probably like a week before it was due.
I had no intention of even like submitting into it. I just really wanted the vocal because like that. I could have a Zoe Johnston vocal to mess around with. That was amazing.
It was like calling in sick to work. Like, I gotta get this done. I don't know if I have a chance, but I gotta get this done.
I ended up doing it and submitting and winning. And I remember the day I went into work and I sat down at my computer to like, you know, just check. And I saw that I had won. And I was like, I knew at that moment, like, it felt like something was gonna happen, but I didn't know like how much was gonna happen.
One of my friends told me that the winner of the remix competition for Above and Beyond was like a dubstep producer. This was before melodic dubstep existed, so I couldn't equate dubstep with being something pretty and ethereal.
This is dubstep. This is what we had been hearing on the playa at Burning Man. This is not something that we thought that they would want.
We listened to the winning remix by some producer I'd never heard of named Seven Lions, and I think myself, like everyone who heard it, was pretty much floored. It was really, you know, it was the beginning of the melodic dubstep genre, I feel like.
I think that in that moment, they really saw Jeff's sound design and his potential and his way with music.
It was a special moment when we first came across Jeff's unique talents. We weren't well versed in dubstep at that point in time, so it wasn't an obvious winner for us to pick, but the Seven Lions remix was impossible to ignore. It stood out from the first listen and was head and shoulders above the other entries we had listened to before it. Musically, sonically, and technically, it was world class. And sure enough, when it came out, everyone loved it, whether they liked dubstep or not. Seven Lions, my favorite DJ.
Jeff reads a lot of fantasy books, and I remember Jeff coming to me and saying, "Hey, I think I found a name for my music project."
I had started a list of names from the different books that I was reading, and I had a whole notepad of different ideas.
"What do you think about Seven Lions?" And I was like, immediately was like, "You."
I guess you could probably tell now that Gene Wolfe was like a big inspiration as far as My name came from a Gene Wolfe book. You know, the mythos is very based on some of his work. His storytelling is also very non-linear. So I think I'm attracted to stories that don't just be like, yo, this is what's happening, and that's it.
When he's Seven Lions, and when he's creating in the realm of Seven Lions, it's very much a story to be told, and the story, I don't even know the full story sometimes.
The Seven Lions mythos, I think, started to develop when we were trying to figure out ways to represent the world visually through like music videos and artwork. I kind of realized you can tell a story in a non-linear way and kind of use a story as an outline for expressing art.
He has so much amazing imagination and storytelling abilities, and not in the traditional sense.
The most special thing about Jeff's music is the environment that he creates. I mean, when you're listening to a track, a lot of them do have a very gradual buildup. It's because he's telling a story. You're going through a journey with him. It's just not straight to the point of the drop.
The composition, the branding, the art design, it had depth that I hadn't seen before. It was much more rich to dive into the Seven Lions universe.
Everything that we put out, there is an intention behind it. Letter forms to colors, to characters, to abstract visuals. It all has a reason for being.
You don't need to be like, this is the story that's happening. But if you create a story and you use that to guide your artistic choices, you know, whether it's what you want to make this artwork about, or if it's what you want this music video to be about, or if it's what your visuals and your show are about, it ends up creating a really cohesive piece of art.
If you imagine the initial ideas of Seven Lions being a seed, we planted that seed, and now in some ways, Seven Lions, even beyond Jeff, it's taken on a life of its own. What the fans are creating in their own heads and their own experience is just as important as the story itself.
He can tell a story very ambiguously that doesn't give you a plot and an answer right away. It lets you create your own story around his interpretation of it, which I think is beautiful, and I don't think that I've seen it before.
I remember just sitting in the hotel rooms before the shows with like the most crippling anxiety, and I didn't even know what anxiety was at that time. Like, I'd never felt those feelings. And then like you go play a show and it's like this brand new thing, and it's this huge amount of energy that comes at you, and it's like almost too much to know what to do with. To move from a reclusive computer guy to a public-facing artist and trying to grapple with that was like intense. I feel like I had to change a lot personally just to keep up.
Everything happened very quickly. It was record labels calling, it was management calling, it was agents calling, and touring for him became hard. I can't imagine touring alone.
There was definitely times, you know, sitting in a hotel room before a show alone in a city I've never been to, just kind of like, I don't know what I'm doing here. I'm pretty open about, I have like a counselor now, and I think every artist honestly should have one. She's been great, and I think it's important to like get that kind of help. And she's helped me kind of identify, you know, that probably was anxiety that I was feeling. I just thought that was part of the process. And honestly, for me, it kind of still is. It's just part of the process. But it was really hard early on doing that alone before Emma was traveling with me.
One day we sat down, I think after a really long tour he had come home from, and we both agreed, you know, this needs more support. And I made the decision to quit my career and go on the road with him for a period of time. I also didn't just want to be on the road rooting him on, you know. I felt like if I'm going to be here, I want to really support you, and I want to learn what I can do to help this touring process, because this is a whole new world. We've met some of the most brilliant minds along the way in the last 10 years, and I'm so proud to, it's not a conventional family, but it's a family.
When we first started working together, he sat in a very unique space. He had been on bus tours. He had been on the road. He had supported other acts on the road. And so I think he got a real good taste on what he liked to do and what he didn't like to do on the road. And so the first incarnation was he wanted to have fun and do cool things on the road.
For me, bus tours are kind of like summer camp. It's kind of like the time for me to go out and do as much fun stuff as I possibly can. I've kind of made it my goal to like really take that opportunity of being in a new city every day to do something fun every day. Yeah, we stay busy on the road for sure. And then we somehow managed to play a show and stay up late, you know, doing our thing.
Milestones were many, from, you know, supporting at a Bill Graham show to headlining and selling it out. Shoreline Amphitheater, Red Rocks, instant sellout. Every tour that was on the road, we have achieved a new milestone for the Seven Lions project.
It's kind of a hard feeling to explain, because like you're exhausted, you're tired, you're like, how am I gonna do this? But as soon as you get up on stage, it's like everything snaps into focus. Everything becomes okay. It's like all these things that have built up in your hours of no sleep and these annoyances and this like, how am I gonna do this? These doubts, it's like they all just, it's crazy.
Chronicles. This has been a vision for Jeff for as long as I can remember. Creating his own world and taking it beyond, you know, whether it's an aesthetic, whether it's a sound, whether it's a feeling, and really creating an immersive experience for the fans. It feels to me that is, and it's always been kind of a cornerstone of what kind of is front and center for Seven Lions. It's that fan experience.
For me, Chronicles is about like an immersive festival experience, and that was my first attempt at trying to bring more environmental art into a show. So you're not just like looking at a stage, you're, you know, experiencing art around you.
My biggest experience on here has just been putting Chronicles together at the Gorge. It definitely takes a team to do a mini festival like that.
We have taken traditional spaces and done our best to transform them and bring you Lord of the Rings meets the Renaissance Fair meets fucking Flash Gordon.
Being like beneath large art installations at a music festival, I feel like is a really awesome experience. So I want to expand on that quite a bit. That was just like the little baby version of what I would like to do in the future.
Chronicles is a celebration of the world and community Seven Lions has created around his music, and Ophelia is a natural extension of that.
The best thing about working with Jeff is his consistent commitment to forging his own path.
Nothing against major labels, but it just wasn't for me because I'm not like a consistent hit pop writer, and I never really will be. That's just not what would make me happy as an artist.
He doesn't care what other people in the space are doing. It's always been like, well, this is what I want to do. This is Seven Lions, like this is the brand. And he's stuck to his guns for 10 years.
After going with a major label, it's like, where do you step off to? So for me, it's time to like build my own space, essentially. The inspiration behind that was just to kind of start a record label for me to release my own music on. And it turned into something totally different.
I've watched Ophelia, you know, from its inception as like just a pure idea to become what it is today. Aside from the music being just consistently top tier electronic music, just all the people on Ophelia is like the real story.
It's cool because a whole scene has kind of grown up around it.
It's palpable at all our live shows. It's palpable online. It's an unspoken bond that if you go to one of these shows or see one of these logos that you might have just found a friend for life.
I see the value in it, not just for me as like an artist, like it's a community thing now.